नमस्कार, वेलकम टू द सीईसी सीरीज ऑफ लेक्चर्स ऑन कंप्यूटर नेटवर्क्स। वी वर डिस्कसिंग अबाउट द प्रोटोकॉल्स एंड द स्टैंडर्ड्स। नाउ टुडे वील टेक अप द रेफरेंस मॉडल्स, द रेफरेंस मॉडल्स फॉर द नेटवर्क आर्किटेक्चर इन कंप्यूटर नेटवर्क्स, OSI मॉडल एंड द TCP/IP प्रोटोकॉल स्वीट। वील ट्राई टू स्क्वीज इन द ओवरव्यू ऑफ both the models today. Before we start discussing the models, a quick review on the few terminologies that we will be using to explain the architecture. We discussed protocols, and if you remember, I said that in computer networks, communication occurs between entities in different systems. Now, what are these entities? Entities is anything that is capable of sending information or receiving information. So entities could be a human being, it could be a software package, it could be a hardware, any part of the computer network. Now, when we talk about entities communicating, talking, receiving, sending information, it is not as simple that one entity will send a raw data bit stream, and it is expected that the receiving entity on a receiving system will understand that. No, it doesn't happen that simply. So both the communicating entities have to agree upon a rule, which is called a protocol. So protocol is a set of rules that govern the data communication, and for communication to happen over a network, the entities have to agree upon a protocol before communication can take place. So protocol basically defines what is communicated, how it is communicated, and when it has to be communicated. So the key elements of a protocol are syntax, semantics, and timing. Let me quickly explain these three key elements. Let's look up syntax first. Syntax refers to the structure or the format of the data in the communication, meaning it is basically telling us about the order in which they are presented. It refers to the order in which these data bits are going to be presented. Let me explain with an example. Now, we have already understood that the actual transmission of any kind of data happens over a physical medium in the form of raw bits. So we are actually transmitting just a sequence of ones and zeros. Now, when we are transmitting ones and zeros in our packets, then maybe the first 8 bits are going to represent the address of the sender. The next 8 bits probably represent the address of the receiver. So when we start associating a order and start associating a structure to our raw bits, then that is called the syntax. The syntax says that the first 8 bits refer to the address. The second key element is the semantics, that is associating a meaning to these data bits. So these data bits have to be interpreted according to the meaning of these bits, and then according to the interpretation, a necessary action is taken. So if syntax says the first 8 bits represent the address of the receiver, then the semantics comes in and says it is the final destination address or it is the immediate next address in the route. So now we have started associating a meaning with the address. That refers to semantics of a protocol, meaning of each section of bits. The third key element of the protocol is the timing, when and how fast the data should be sent. When and how fast the data should be sent, it cannot go at a rate which is decided alone by the sending machine. The receiving machine, the bandwidth of the network in between, everything plays a role, and the protocol which decides the timing will determine how fast the data has to be sent and exactly when it should be sent. That means how often a packet can be sent in a second. So the key elements of the protocol are syntax, semantics, and timing. Last time also I had just touched upon another requirement, another entity which is used in data communication, and that's standards. Standards are different from protocols. Standards are also necessary because they create and maintain a open and competitive market for the manufacturers, for the vendors. And because there are standards, it guarantees a national and international interoperability of the various networks. Basically, standards provide guidelines to various equipment manufacturers, to the vendors, to government agencies, to all the service providers for these networking mechanisms. And standards are developed by the cooperation of standards creation committees, forums and regulatory agencies. These three together they develop standards, and they are basically like they are like protocols, but they have been agreed upon much before the network processes are coming into the picture. So we have two types of standards, de facto and de jure. De facto standards are those that have not been approved by any organized body, but they have been adopted because of their widespread use. They have been used over a long period of time and they have been now adopted as standards. So usually they have been established by manufacturers. So these are the de facto standards. The second category is de jure. These are the standards that have been legislated by an officially recognized body, and they are officially placed in the picture as standards. So both standards are used, they are in common use, and just the way they have been adopted kind of differentiates them between de facto and de jure standards. Now let's look at an internetwork. Now, computer network is a collection of autonomous computers which have been interconnected by a single technology. That makes up one computer network. And computers are said to be connected if they are capable of exchanging information. And networks come in various forms, size, shapes. We have been discussing that in our previous lectures. We did the LANs, the WANs and the MANs, and we also did various kinds of technology that goes into building up a network. So each network is made up of hardware and software. Hardware part of the network is responsible for carrying the raw bits of data across the transmission medium, and the software basically consists of all the instruction sets that gives us the services that we expect from a network. Now there are many networks in our world, and it is possible that a person on one network wishes to communicate with a person on another network which is probably in a remote area or very distant from the person's current network. Now networks have incompatibilities because they have been made as stand-alone networks. And for networks to be able to communicate with each other, we need some processing, we need some translation mechanisms which can overlook the inherent differences between individual networks. And that's what we do in computer networks. So computer networks will provide for connecting devices, for sophisticated translators which will make the incompatibility transparent to the human users. And once these various networks are combined together with the help of these sophisticated connecting devices, we have interconnected networks, and that is what is called as an internetwork. So, internetwork is a collection of networks connected by connecting devices which makes the underlying incompatibility transparent to the users. The internet which we are all using today is one example of a very large internetwork. But we can have very small internetworks also which are combining the various networks owned by one business or maybe one category. So you can have many examples of internetwork. The internet is just one example of the internetwork, and it is the largest internetwork today. Now there are three more terms which we need to distinguish when we talk about computer networks. Internetworks generally gets confused with the word networks and subnets. So let's look up these two terms also. Now, subnets are usually used in the context of a wide area network, the WANs. WANs we had discussed in our last lecture. So those of you who wish to understand or recap what a WAN is, they can just look up the last lecture. So subnets are basically collection of very specialized connecting devices called routers and the communication lines. Both of these are usually owned by the network operator. I can give you one analogy here. In our telephone system, you have the actual telephone which you possess. And these telephones get connected to telephones of your friends or your contacts through telephone lines and these telephone offices. Now, these telephone lines and offices are not in your control. That is kind of a subnet for the telephone system. We have routers and communication lines which form the subnets in computer networks. And the telephone which you possess is like a host in a network. So you have subnets and hosts like the telephone lines and the actual telephone. Network is a combination of a subnet and its hosts that makes up one network. An interconnection of distinct networks is what is a internetwork. Now, how do you define a distinct network? There are various ways. You know, the underlying technology can make networks into separate entities. Like a LAN is one network, another WAN could be another network, a LAN with a different technology could be one network. Sometimes you also differentiate between networks depending upon who constructed it or who owns it or who's paying for its maintenance. That could also be one way of having distinct networks. And of course, different kinds of technologies, like whether it's a broadcast network or it is a point-to-point network, is it a wired network, it's a wireless network, that also categorizes your networks. But interconnection of any kind of network makes up a internetwork. So subnet is a collection of routers and communication lines. Networks is a combination of a subnet and all its hosts that it is catering to. And internetworks is interconnection of distinct networks. Going back to understanding a little more about the protocols, we already explained to you what a protocol is. It is basically a rule which is going to govern the data communication. And networks, all networks are organized as a stack of layers, or sometimes we call them levels also. Each layer is built upon a layer below it. So it is a hierarchical structure, and all networks are understood best in the form of this layering. The number of layers, the name of each layer, the contents of each layer, and the functionality of each layer differs from network to network. Each network, according to its requirement, will vary the contents and the functionality of each layer. The purpose of each layer, irrespective of what network it is, but the purpose of each layer is to offer services to the higher layers. It's a little bit of an abstract thing to understand, but I can give you an example from a real life where we can understand this concept of layering. The example is the postal system. So two friends wish to communicate. There is a sender, there is a receiver, these are the two entities, and then there is a medium through which the letter is going to be carried. Now, what happens first? First, the sender will write a letter, will insert this letter into an envelope, write the address, and then leave it in the mailbox. Now, we put all these functions as a higher layer function. All these are done in one go by one person. So, it's kind of a distinct collection of functionalities which happens in one go, and therefore we kind of put them together in a layer. After that, the letter carrier or the postman has to come and pick up this letter from your mailbox and take it to the post office. That forms the middle layer. Now, from the post office, there are letters which have arrived from various destinations in the city. So, they have to be sorted. They have to be checked where they are headed for, and accordingly, they are put on a carrier. Now, carrier could be anything. Carrier could be a truck, could be a bus, could be a railway, could be a person. So, that depends upon where is the destination of this letter. Now, it could also take up combination of various carriers. Depending upon the destination, this letter will use the services of the carrier and will be physically transported by the carrier to the destination. At the destination, exactly the same things happen, but in the reverse order. This letter first goes to the post office, it is sorted there, and from there the postman carries it to the mailbox of the receiver, and from the mailbox the receiver will receive it, will look at the address, will check it is for this person himself, will take out the letter and read. So it is a very, very simple concept, but the way I have put it is making it seem as if there was a lot happening between writing the letter and reading the letter, and actually a lot does happen. And this layering is exactly what we follow in computer networks. So there are higher layers, there is a middle layer, and there is the lower layer. The lower layer is the last to receive the data from the sender side, but first to receive the data on the receiver side. Lower layer actually communicates with the physical transmission of the entity, of the physical transmission of the message. And exactly similar things happen in the networks too. Now, this figure is showing you a simple networking system. There are two hosts here, host 1 and host 2. These two hosts wish to communicate. The hosts are basically computers. There are two devices and they wish to exchange information. Data communication over computer networks means exchange of information and data. Now, every networking system is organized as a layered architecture. So, you see here, I have put layer 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Analogy is with the postal system. Please keep that at the back of your mind. The entities which comprise the corresponding layers on the two hosts are called peers. So, layer 5, the boxes, they are the peers. Layer 4 are layer 4 peers, so on and so forth. And as you can see, each layer is built upon the layer under it. So, layer 2 is on layer 1, layer 3 is on layer 2, so on and so forth. Now, there is a virtual communication happening at each layer, and that is shown by dotted lines. The solid lines which are happening between the layers on the same host is where the actual communication is happening. So, layer 5 of host 1 communicates with layer 5 of host 2 virtually. That means whatever was being done at layer 5 at the sender side, similar processes are happening at layer 5 on the receiver side, and they are governed by the same protocol. So, layer 5 protocol will manage the virtual communication between layer 5 on each host. But in the actual scenario, the communication is not horizontal, it is vertical. So, host 1 will put the message on layer 5, layer 5 will pass it down to layer 4, then to layer 3, the layer 2 and layer 1, and then layer 1, which is the lowest layer, is now connected directly with the physical medium, will deposit the bits on the physical medium. Physical medium will carry the bits and will take it to the destination. And at each layer, the data will travel up till it reaches host 2. So, this is how the networks are created. A set of layers and protocols. The set of layers and protocols with the physical medium is what is called as a network architecture. And a list of protocols, one protocol usually for each layer, is called the protocol set for that architecture. Now, there is one more thing which I want to mention here, that is, you see these solid lines, they also have a name, they are called interfaces. So, each layer makes an interface with the layer below it. And if these are the middle layers, then they make interfaces with the layer above it and the layer below it. And generally the names of the interfaces are as shown in the figure. Between 4 and 5 it is called layer 4-5 interface. Between 4 and 3 it is called layer 3-4 interface. So peers, protocols and interfaces. Interfaces are where the abstraction is provided. It kind of distinctly separates the functionalities of the two layers. So interfaces are important when you are designing your architecture. Now the same architecture, but a little more technical details here. I have the five layers. I have the source machine and the destination machine, which is my host 1 and host 2. There are these specified protocols for each layer. The source machine and the destination machine, if you can see, are actually connected by the solid line at layer 1. All the upper layers are doing a virtual communication at peer level. The message originates in layer 5. And this message is passed down to layer 4. The layer 4 will add something which is written as a H. H4 is called as a header, which gets added at every layer. Header basically contains control information, which probably is the function of that particular layer. For example, layer 4 here could be adding the address of the process which is generating this message. So it is giving a mechanism of identifying this message. Now this H4 plus M is passed down to layer 3. And layer 3 is probably looking at how this message is going to be transmitted and realizes that they need to be fragmented. They need to be broken into fixed size or maybe variable sized smaller fragments. So it has now divided the message from layer 4 into smaller fragments and has also added its own header telling about how this has been fragmented and how it has to be reassembled. Now if you look at the peer level on the destination machine at layer 3, layer 3 will be receiving it exactly the way layer 3 divided it. The header 3 information will guide the destination machine how to reassemble these fragments. So that is what is meant by layer 3 protocol. The protocol will determine for both the source and the destination the semantics, the syntax and the timing for each layer, what has been done and what has to be undone. This then gets passed on to layer 2, where you see that not only a header has been added, not only a header, but also a trailer, the T. So the layer 2 is adding control information in the header form, but it adds some additional information in the form of trailer, and this could be some error correcting mechanisms. So every layer adds some bits of information which are called headers and trailers, and then the lowest layer will pass on this entire packet of data physically onto the destination machine. In the destination machine, whatever was done at each layer, exactly the same process is done on that machine in that layer. The headers and trailers are stripped at every layer and the packet is passed on to the layers above it minus the headers and trailers of the layer below it. So if you see, layer 3 will not have the headers and trailers which were added by layer 2. Layer 4 will not have the headers of H3. So this is how the communication is happening between two machines according to a particular network architecture. So this is a network architecture because it is defining layers, it is defining a protocol set or a protocol stack, it is also defining the interfaces, and it is showing you the headers and the trailers. The protocols are shown by the blue arrows and the headers and trailers are shown by the black arrows. Now let's look at some important design issues when we design a network. First and most important issue is a reliability. Now, all networks are expected to be reliable. It should not happen that you send a data and a wrong data or a data in error reaches the destination. So, the most important requirement from the network is error detection, and this can be done in the form of adding some codes which will let the destination machine know that the bits which have been received are either inverted, that means they are in error, or they have been missed out. So then of course, once the error is detected, you can always send a request to the source machine to retransmit that data. And there are more sophisticated forms of these codes which once detect the errors have the capability of correcting the errors also. So error detection and correction are an important design issue, and they come under reliability. The second important design issue is routing. Now when you are in a inter-network where various networks are connected to each other, you do not know how your data packet from the source is going to reach the destination. It's going to pass through many connecting devices and maybe many networks in its route. So the subnet and the devices, the connecting devices en route, will have to take some decisions with regard to its path. The packet has to take the best path to the destination, and that is what is called as routing. And routing has to be done in such a manner that the packets do not get lost. At the same time, they reach the destination in the minimum amount of time. So reliability is a very important design issue. The second design issue is evolution. You know, all the networks, they are growing all the time. The designs are getting sophisticated, they are evolving. So we want our networks to be scalable. So even if it is growing, even if it is changing, the networks should continue to work the way they are. That's what's called as evolution and scalability. There has to be a good addressing mechanism, because when you add new devices to your networks, the addressing should be such that every host on the internet network should have a unique identification. So evolution and reliability are important design issues. And there are two more design issues, resource allocation and security, which we will discuss shortly. Thank you.